Excellent. Okay, thank you everyone for joining us this evening. My name is Will Smith and I work as a bookseller at Sam Reed's Bookshop in Grasmere in the centre of the Lake District. I'm delighted this evening that we get the chance to talk to Sharon Gosling. Sharon is going to be talking to us about her new book, The Lighthouse Bookshop. I have a lovely bio to read in a second to give you a context on that, but at present I'd just like to also just thank everyone for coming out this evening and joining us online in this virtual space to hear an amazing author talking about an amazing new book. And during the event we will have subtitles hopefully available to you that are popping up along your screen that will give an approximation of the kind of thing we will be saying. They're not perfect. They have some problems with technical wording, but they'll give you a sense of the kind of conversation we'll be having. The event will last about an hour. It will be a mixture of reading, conversation, and there will be opportunity towards the end to put your own questions to Sharon. So if during the event something crosses your mind, do please pop it in the chat box on Zoom and we will get to it as we progress. Okay. So this evening, Sharon Gosling and the Lighthouse Bookshop. I'm going to hold up the book here. Simon and Schuster just out now. So Sharon and her husband, the founder of Withnail Books in Penrith, live in a very remote village in northern Cumbria, surrounded by fells, sheep, and a host of lovely neighbours who I'm told will one day make very good characters in their own book. When Sharon isn't writing, she dabbles in lino cut, printmaking, bakes too much, and attempts to grow things in an allotment. Her latest middle grade children's adventure, The Extraordinary Voyage of Katie Willicott, has just been published with Stripes. And she's now written two adult novels, The House Beneath the Cliffs, and now the subject of our event this evening, The Lighthouse Bookshop. There we are. So thank you, Sharon, for joining us this evening. I'm so glad we could do this.
Thank you so much for having me. I really appreciate it. It's lovely to chat to you.
I'm so excited to get the chance to talk to you, not least because there are very few times when as a reader we get that opportunity, but also because I've loved your books and this is the first time I've got to ask you any questions about them. So I often think that the fascinating thing about an author's work is to wonder kind of what prompted it, where it came from. So I'm really interested, particularly in the Lighthouse Bookshop, what was the kind of seed of this novel?
Well, I was thinking about this the other day when you told me when we talked about what you were going to ask me. And it's always quite hard to untangle where an idea comes from because it's just a massive mix of everything that goes into your head and gets shaken around and something comes out. But I actually, I remember a long time ago, probably about 20 years ago, I wrote a novella about a bookshop. And this, I guess, is an extension of that. But actually where this specific idea came from was when I was working on The House Beneath the Cliffs and we were talking to different publishers. There was one publisher who we didn't end up, not Simon and Schuster, we didn't end up going with them, but they wanted to see what sequel ideas I had. And the editor that I was talking to said, can we have a lighthouse? I really like lighthouses. Can you write a book about lighthouses? And then when I was thinking about what I wanted to write after the House Beneath the Cliffs, so I was like, yeah, I'll write a book about a lighthouse. And obviously it's a lot more involved than that, but I have that editor to thank for putting that seed in my head because it definitely got me thinking about, you know, what other stuff was going around my head and where that could come. And you know, lighthouses, they're fantastic. I love lighthouses, they're awesome things. So it made absolute sense to make up a story about one.
That's excellent to hear. I love that idea that people were suggesting topics to you.
Can you put one in a lighthouse? Yeah, why not?
do we know if was there a sales track record for lighthouses in books? Was that?
I don't know. Very possibly. I mean, the cover really stands out, doesn't it? I mean, it just looks really interesting. So, very possibly. I don't know, but I think it was also possibly just a rather like the character in the book who has a fascination with lighthouses. I think they are extraordinary buildings and you know, the physics of them and the design of them are very eye-catching and catch the imagination. So yeah, I think this person just liked lighthouses.
Completely. Oh, that's wonderful. And so, and obviously it was kind of tied to then the House Beneath the Cliffs in terms of where it was coming from. It was always a planned kind of follow on then as a book project.
Not really, I didn't want to write a sequel. I'm a bit of a scatterbrain really, and I just kind of like doing different stuff, and the idea of writing sequels doesn't really appeal to me, but there are a few of my children's stories I'd quite like to go back and revisit a few years later, but I think writing them in sequence I would find that quite difficult. But this is kind of set in the same universe, so it shares certain aspects, and it's not set on the same coast, but it's definitely, you know, you realize at some point in the book you realize that it is set in the same, yeah, the same fictional universe as The House Beneath the Cliffs, I guess you could say. So there is a connection, yeah.
That's wonderful. We'll come back to that because I am fascinated by that too. But I wonder whether maybe to begin with we could hear a passage from the book to get a sense of this, which obviously can, it should be said, be read as an entirely standalone novel for those of you who haven't yet read The House Beneath the Cliffs.
Yes, it's not. It isn't that connected at all. It's just, I'm just going to read a couple of pages just from the beginning, from the first chapter. For Rachel, the day started the same way as every other, with Eustace meowing loudly in her ear. She opened her eyes and rolled onto her back. Above her, the white papered ceiling of her small circular bedroom looked the same as it had for the past 5 years. The tower's windows were small in its thick stone walls, and even at this early juncture of the morning, the irony was not lost on her. That a lighthouse should be so very lacking in illumination seemed deliberately perverse. Rachel dodged the cat on the short set of curving steps down to her tiny half moon of the kitchen. The cat had come with the lighthouse, but Rachel had no illusions that he was hers. Eustace belonged to Colin MacDonald, just as the tower did and always would, no matter that he no longer actually lived within its walls. Rachel put down Eustace's food and stroked his old head for a moment, wondering how long it would be until he, like his owner, would find the stairs too much to manage. Later, ready for the day, Rachel walked the spiral staircase down to the bookshop, Eustace with her all the way. At the bottom of the curving flight of steps that led down from the two tiny floors of living quarters was a heavy wooden door that let her out onto the upper mezzanine floor. From this level, the staircase down to the bookshop's ground floor was built of wrought iron and set against the wall. She and Cullen had debated this at length throughout Rachel's tenure as manager. This place had been built as a library in the first place, so why hadn't the architect put the stairs at the centre like a spindle instead? That would have given more space on the impractically curved walls, and the bookshop could certainly use the extra room now. Cullen would not hear of changing any aspect of the tower's internal workings beyond what he'd already altered when he originally moved into it 60 years before, and even then he'd modified as little as possible about the cavernous space that housed his beloved books. It was obviously inherited, this adoration of the printed page, a genetic predisposition passed down intact in a way that the money responsible for housing it in such an eccentric place was not. There were only two additions that Cullen had allowed, the tiny ground floor bathroom facilities and the semicircular counter set in the centre of the lower room. The latter housed a plethora of drawers and shelves full of things both important and forgotten. This included, but was not limited to, the till, a lurking explosion of invoices and bills, a laptop as old in computer years as the lighthouse itself, a kettle, the makings for tea and coffee, a toaster, a bread bin, and a domed glass cake stand. I'll stop there.
Thank you. I'm glad we got the kind of layout of the bookshop itself there. I love that description of the bookshop counter particularly. Mainly because it's kind of got parallels, hasn't it, to the sort of drawers you have at home, that bookshop counters are spaces where things accumulate.
Yes. I also think that possibly unfairly, and I'm not casting aspersions on you as a bookseller, but possibly the idea of a secondhand bookshop in particular, you get a kind of ramshackle sense of it being ramshackle and think, you know, the important thing is the books, organization is not so important. I think that's what I was trying to convey there. I think that's Cullen's attitude, certainly.
I think a career in bookselling tells me that, yeah, the theatre is the thing out the front, and then the back, you don't want to see behind the scenes a lot of the time. It is chaos. So yeah, that I love that. But I also love that kind of welcoming feeling that you've got in the bookshop there, that there's a kettle, there's a toaster. Early on, it's a really welcoming space as a hub, as a center of this narrative, where all of the characters feel probably too at home for a commercial endeavor, to be honest. I love that then forms this kind of crossing point for all of the characters within the story. And so the bookshop is this kind of hub of the narrative you create. But I wonder, was it hard to kind of juggle the amount of characters you have within the narrative? Because it's also a book, not just about the bookshop, but about the village within which it's situated.
It was quite tricky. The first draft was quite too long, by about 30,000 words. And I had to cut it quite a lot because it's quite hard. There's 4 or 5 different characters that have voices in the book, and juggling that was quite difficult, just from the point of view of not letting in, you don't want someone to just disappear in the middle of a text, and keeping it balanced. But I also, that was kind of part of the community feeling, like I wanted it to feel like this really was a somewhere that everyone came and stayed, essentially. This was their home from home, and it's a living area really, rather than a bookshop, which I think is exactly the kind of, as a book lover and a lover of bookshops, it's exactly the kind of bookshop I love is to walk in. And there's one in Inverness, and I can't remember what it's called. Have you been to the Inverness bookshop, which is huge? It's in an old chapel, and they've got a massive fire right in the middle of it, like a wood burning stove in the middle of it. Which was partly the inspiration for the stove in the Lighthouse Bookshop. And that feels, and there's a cafe in there, and that feels, even though it's a really big building, it feels very cozy. It feels like somewhere you can just go and hang out for hours, which I think people tend to do in secondhand bookshops in particular.
That's wonderful. That's great to hear. That's the inspiration. I haven't been to that bookshop. I've had friends visit and I've read about it. I've seen photographs, I think, too. So it's great that there is a partial inspiration through another bookshop. So when you've got all of these characters who feel, more than at home, playing chess, browsing, coming in and out. How did you then figure out, what the through line of the story would be? Because we have the story about Rachel and the bookshop, which seems to be the backbone of the whole book. And yet, all of these other characters have got really compelling backstories. Was there someone who you were kind of considering more than others at points, who then had their plot narrowed somewhat in the drafting?
Yeah, I think I don't want to talk too much about it because I don't want to give too much away.
Sure.
But I certainly went into it thinking that one particular couple was going to be the central story. And then I found myself drawn to, Jilly became a lot bigger than I thought she was going to be, actually. She became a much more central character, and I really loved her in the end. She was one of those characters that just appeared out of nowhere, and it's like, oh, well, there she is, and that's who she is. And I could hear her voice, and she felt very real to me very quickly. And then the story of her kind of progression, that she had quite an arc. And everything fed into that, really, in a way. And then the story of the building itself, I think probably came quite a bit later, actually. Rachel finding out more about why it was built and things like that. But the building is a central, almost a character in its own right, that then became the spine of the story, because if it wasn't there, then where would all these people go? And yes, they would still be connected and they would still be friends, but this was where they spent their time. So I think that became the through line in a much stronger way than I was expecting when I first started writing it, I think.
And I think a lot about the kind of villagey nature of the book in that sense, that, it's the village hub. But in some sense, you've got the wonderful Fretted Goose, the local pub, which is a fantastic pub name as well. But that seems like it's got some kind of contention for another space where people go, they hear the gossip, they socialise, they overhear things as well. It's got that lovely quality that, again, a kind of a local space has. Were you kind of aware that you were also trying to mimic that kind of villagey feeling of where you get the gossip?
Yeah, definitely. And I think here in Croglin, which is a very small village, we have a post office that only open 4 hours a week, 2 hours on Tuesdays and 2 hours on Thursdays. And it's after that's been opened that news is disseminated quite quickly, even though we've got a village WhatsApp and everything, but it seems to be still news travels fastest when people, you know, come in and out and in. So yeah, I think that's probably, it's a little bit of that. And we've got, you know, fantastic pub, it's called the Bluebell here as well, that very much is a community space. So I think that is probably recognizable for people that live in a small community that is maybe a little bit out of the way, that there will always be places that people hang out and gather and chat, even with all the technology that we have today. I think that's still a factor, I think, in village life.
Mm. And yet you've got that wonderful kind of weaving in of technology, haven't you? That, and I like the nod even in that reading to the kind of dilapidated laptop in the bookshop. There is this kind of exercise of some digital qualities to the journalism. I mean, the newspaper archive crops up at one point. There are things which are clearly an active part of their research in everyday life. And yet it does show the very human kind of non-digital function of our everyday lives as well in terms of village life.
I was just saying that was quite a funny edit that when I was trying to cut the first draft down, my editor, who's younger than me, and it showed because I'd originally, when they start scanning documents in the building, I'd said that they have to go and find a scanner to do it, and just like, they can just use the phone. I was like, oh yeah. Like, that was an indication that she's a bit younger than I am. I hadn't even thought about that.
The modernizing approach throughout then.
Yeah.
So I guess I'm interested in some of the angles of the kind of puzzles that they have to unravel, and how they're incredibly warm and human, essentially, that we are getting the characters themselves. And I wonder whether, you know, Gilly gives you a way to do that, because Gilly, it's not saying too much to say that she is a kind of runaway at the start, and therefore she is exploring a place in ways that she has no access to anyone to look after her. She has no kind of set method of being in that space. So she's, you know, you don't get that many homeless figures in contemporary literature who are brought in. So was that a kind of factoring in to think about what a homeless figure in a community like a village would do and be?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. I don't even know where Gilly came from originally. I think I was looking for younger characters that I wanted to include, but homelessness is, I'm interested in homelessness and how I react to how homelessness affects a person in all sorts of ways, how it dehumanizes someone, and how we react to people that don't have fixed abodes, I think is quite interesting. And she has a vague connection to the lighthouse, because her grandma, when she was very young, when her grandma was still alive, she did bring her to the lighthouse. So that's kind of why she's drawn to it. And the idea that you're drawn to places that you know, she obviously had that connection, like she felt some connection, and why we find places to feel homely. And I think it was a darker element as well. I wanted to, you know, put that darker element in there. And how would just how place can affect people in a positive way, which then can be, you know, a transferable positivity to other people, I think, if that probably doesn't make sense. I think that's probably where that came from.
Yeah, so because it is a kind of an energy, isn't it? You can, as part of the arc of the building of the community, or the reflection of what already exists in terms of the bookshop space and the people who gather there, it's a tangible kind of benefit of the friendship and acknowledgement and the socializing that's gone on there that kind of is attributed to Gilly, who ends up tending the bookshop counter quite quickly, it seems, from a chance discovery, which is also
it's also the whole idea of the knock-on effect. Like, Rachel was given a chance, and then that made her more likely to give someone else a chance. And I'm also kind of interested in the idea of buildings holding atmosphere, which they very clearly do, but we don't quite know why, really. It's a bit, you know, it's the stone tapes, isn't it, of the idea that walls hold memories or you know, some form of spirituality, or, you know, whatever you want to call it. Like our house here, we're built into the side of a graveyard. And yet our house feels, everyone who comes into it says our house feels like it's a happy place, like it's a happy building. And it has always felt like that. Like it's always had families in it. It's always had a positive thing. And for some, you know, why do buildings hold that? I don't know. But I think if you're going to have a bookshop in a lighthouse, it's going to be a good place. Yeah. It's going to be good.
I know we were talking about this a bit before, but as a bookshop, it is a kind of space too, isn't it? Like bookshops are themselves type kind of categories of space that accumulate certain kinds of hopefully goodwill, hopefully a good kind of environment. There's something kind of unique about them. It's not just retail that you've gone into when you've gone into that kind of area.
I think that's very true, actually. Yeah, it's not just a transactional space. There's something else going on there. It's finding stories and
did you draw upon yours and your partner's experiences in bookselling when you were thinking about writing this bookshop as well?
I'm not sure I did specifically. I think it must I mean, Adam's the one that's always in the shop. I'm not behind the counter ever. That wouldn't be good for the bookshop. He tells me stories, obviously, of people that come into the shop and things that he's found, and I think mainly his enthusiasm over books is fantastic, and he'll come home with boxes of books and be really enthusiastic about showing me just the books he's found and the history behind them. You know, you pull out a book that's 60 years old, and you know, however old, and our house is full of books like that are, you know, first edition Dore and stuff like that, and I think so it's the, I guess it's just the atmosphere that my life is in, really. And, you know, we go into a lot of bookshops as well. So there's a lot of research incidentally.
That's good. Can you claim against that if you're, you know, it's part of you?
I should, yeah. I should write it all down. Every single one I've been into for the last 2 years, that would be good.
Entire research for ACE, yeah. And also in the book you have, so you're not just got kind of that reflection of bookshop space and how it extends out, but you do have baking, and you have another character who is interested in, well, professional at lino cuts, and that becomes a key part of the story. Was it kind of, again, an interesting choice to kind of overlap on your own kind of expertise and pursuits and kind of fit your characters with some of the same sorts of interests?
It was, I think, the baking came from the first novella that I wrote about the bookshop, actually, which I now realise, thinking about it now, I realised that there was a very similar character to Rachel in that had not really occurred to me until I started thinking about it. But that was always the idea of, there was always going to be cake, you know, a new cake every day kind of thing. And people came in for cake, even if they didn't come in for books, they'd come in for cake. So I think that just came from that. And then I had to ignore the logistics of having cake in a bookshop and how you would stop customers with sticky fingers picking up. Don't think about that. And then Edie, when I made Edie an artist, originally I think she was going to be a painter. And then I thought, why don't I make her a, you know, I've learned lino printing in the last few years. And I'm very much a novice, but I enjoy doing it. And I know the process. It's like, well, you know, write what you know, make her a print artist. So that's where that came from. And it's, you know, I could write convincingly about that because I know it. I didn't have to go and learn. You know, the kids book that I've just written, Katie Willicott, The Extraordinary Voyage of Katie Willicott, she goes off and it's about a girl who dresses up as a boy to join a voyage to find a meteorite in Brazil in 1879. And I had to learn how to sail just so I knew not, you know, what I had to leave out of writing about sailing. And it was very hard. So I was like, no, just use something you already know about, so you don't have to read and learn about it. So that's where that came from.
And it's a lovely part of the story, because obviously Edie's artistic practice is in itself a kind of, it's a response to place, it's a response to the Lighthouse Bookshop at points, and not just in terms of the commercial relationship of stocking the cards and such, but the kind of the drawing of on the everyday for inspiration is sort of part of Edie's world and is passed on to Jilly then too. It's in itself a really lovely part of the kind of education that's developed throughout the story. So I love the specificity of that, I suppose, in how it turns the story along, and it has a real outcome as we're heading through. But then there are other characters. Well, there are other characters who have their own kind of traumatic backgrounds, and less so perhaps with Edie, although Edie is confronting difficulties. But we've got Toby, who has these sorts of flashbacks and night terrors, which, you know, relate to his career as a journalist. And I wonder whether, particularly when you're thinking of that, and you're thinking of the, even from the prologue, the allusion to the fact that Rachel has had a life further away from the bookshop, which she has escaped to be, you know, given this second chance at a life at the bookshop, you know, whether it was difficult to manage tone. You said Jilly was there kind of adding some necessary darkness, but you've got a number of characters who haven't had the easiest of lives. And how did you kind of navigate them dealing with that, and also, you know, finding this wonderful place to actually reconcile or feel at home again?
I think I always tend towards darkness. I don't know why. I always end up putting dark things in my writing without really meaning to. I think to write the happier side of things, you need to have a contrast. And it was again about showing how at whatever stage of life these characters were at, coming to the bookshop and meeting those like-minded people in that space gave them the space and the time to heal from whatever they are going through. And Toby specifically comes to find the lighthouse because he's heard about it, but he's actually trying to write about his own experiences, his own memoirs. He's supposed to be writing a memoir about being a journalist. And can't do it. He's used to writing about other people, not himself. And I think, I think the darkness is necessary. I can't write just happy stuff. I don't know why. I always end up putting something slightly darker in there, which I think tempers. Mm-hmm. Tempers the story a bit, and it also helps with the arc of the story for me as well, which I think is I think they all have, as you say, they all have things that they end up leaving behind in the course of the story to get to a better place, which is all aided by the bookshop and the building and the friends that they make there. So I don't think I was asked to make it less dark. There have been points where my editors have said, can you, it might be a little bit too dark. Maybe don't start off with mugging. Maybe don't have drive-by shooting. But this one was just naturally felt that worked, I think, for this story.
And I suppose the other thinking behind the story, I'm intrigued by the kind of Scottishness, I suppose, of the setting too, that it is, because it's sort of within that same fictional world as The House Beneath the Cliffs, it ends up being this bookshop in a village at the foot of the Cairngorms. Were you ever kind of, like, how did that factor into what you were writing? Were you ever tempted to set this elsewhere, or was it always going to be another one in your fictional Aberdeenshire?
Originally, I thought I was going to set it in Cumbria, actually. I thought I was going to set it on the coast in Cumbria, possibly around St. Bee, something like that. And I don't know at what point I decided that, no, it would work better in Scotland. But I just love Scotland. I think with distances as well, even though obviously Cumbria has a lot of distances. But I think that there's something about the landscape around that area of Scotland, around Aberdeenshire. And it did give me an opportunity to go back to Crivi, if only briefly. And I think it just linked up better. I think it had to do with the development aspect and the idea that it could sometime, that, you know, at some point someone might want to do something else with that the land that the lighthouse is on. So it needed to be somewhere where that was feasible. And I think that it just worked better for me to make it a fictional place, that, you know, in a fictional town not far from Crewe. I think that's what happened.
And but then you've got all those dimensions of history and land use, which all seem, they all ring true for a Scottish setting. I think that the both the kind of proximity of councils and developers, perhaps, and yet you've also got this kind of estate history that's playing into the landscape too. So it feels, you know, like it didn't need to have once been thought of as elsewhere, that it feels entirely grounded in the space you've created. And I suppose my question for you in terms of then the extended Gosling Scotland universe is, you know, is that building, are we seeing like a D. Richardson? Are we going to get lots of kind of or another narrative set within that same kind of universe? Is that tempting?
It's definitely tempting. The next one is not set in Scotland, actually. I'm just finishing it now, and it is set in Cumbria. But I think I'll always go back to, always want to go back to Scotland. It's a just such an amazing place, and the, you know, the history, obviously history around here as well, but the, like you say, the idea of a great estate that's kind of crumbled into nothing. And I think there's probably more spaces to set that kind of story in the area that I've chosen in Scotland. And also any excuse I've got to get to, you know, go take my characters to Crewe every now and then is great.
That's wonderful. That is wonderful. I mean, there's obviously so much potential. And as you say, the kind of, well, the character that really stood out for me, I love bit part characters anyway, but the character I loved here was Alan Crosswick, and his sort of, he's a solicitor who drifts in and out of the narrative, but I love people like that. And you often wonder then what's happening off stage, I guess. And that the idea that this still has Crewe within it, because gives you the sense there is an offstage, and it's kind of a living, breathing narrative world. So I'm always fascinated by that kind of, there's always a hint to the reader that you are reading a portion of a life, you're reading an episode, but there's so much more outside of it. I'm fascinated if this is something, that can build, I guess. Not, I'm not saying you have to write a novel about, it's solely about Alan Crosswick now.
Alan Crosswick, I'm sure there's one somewhere. I love the fact that you said that you thought he sounded like, in your head, he was Bill Patterson. I love Bill Patterson, he's great. Fantastic actor.
Yes, well, I was reviewing it for Cumbria Life, and I just thought all the way through, he just sounds like Bill Patterson. Like in my head reading it, I had Bill Patterson coming in and delivering news, because there's such a, I think it comes down to tone as well some of the time. You know, when you've got a professional character who's trying to be warm and acknowledging of Rachel's role in the community as a bookseller, but also there may be changes going on, and he seems so good at like delivering qualified news that is kind of good-hearted, but
exposition, it's trying to get exposition in there without it sounding like exposition. Everyone needs a Bill Patterson for that.
And then at one point you have a phone call to America, which changes the dynamic somewhat in this book. Was that, how did that kind of function for you too? The sudden introduction of a kind of an American character off screen, if you like, who's phoned.
I wanted that again, to expand that universe a bit, and to make the threat to the lighthouse larger. Like, it's not just about what's going on in the immediate. But also, I don't know if this is too much of a spoiler, I didn't want to write an American who is a baddie. you get stories that are set in small, out of the way places, and it's the incomer from a long way away that is kind of cast as the bad sort. And I wanted to do something different. So that's why. I'm going to say this might diminish me as an author somewhat, but we'd been chain watching ER during lockdown while I was writing this. So that's why she's a doctor at Duke University Hospital, because.
these are a crucial parts of the narrative process we need to hear about. Yeah, the writing.
And the influences.
So you didn't want that kind of local hero feeling then about the kind of...
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, absolutely. Like, just because these are the characters that care about the building doesn't mean to say they're the only people that are going to care about the building. I wanted that different flavour in there.
That's wonderful. So when you... The other thing I think is kind of interesting, when you're writing this, and it may have been a part of when you're writing The House Beneath the Cliffs too, did you have... You know, other writing you admired that you were thinking, this, I want this to sit beside that. You know, there's a conscious feeling, because I'm aware you've done lots of writing in different forms and formats. And when you're setting about writing this novel, how did you kind of get a sense of the kind of writing you wanted it to be like? Did you have any models or anything that you were aiming at all?
No, I mean, there's always authors that you would love to emulate, but trying to do that is a not a healthy thing, really, because you know you can only write what you can write. I have many authors that I might... One problem I do have, actually, is that as you say, I write in a lot of different mediums and different, you know, I write full-on horror, I write children's fiction, and I don't really think of myself as a romance author, so I quite often find myself second guessing myself about what's going into my books, because I'm like this shouldn't be in a romance novel. Talking about the darkness, in fact, you know, this isn't what this book, my book has to, you know, this is how my book is being sold and this is what it has to be, and that can be really stymieing as an author, when you think you aren't doing what you should be doing in terms of the genre that you are being positioned in. And I find that quite difficult. And so I think, actually, rather than trying to emulate something, it was more about letting go and just going, I just have to write the story that I am going to write. And particularly for me with this book, when we sold The House Beneath the Cliffs, I'd already written it. So it was already, you know, they knew what they were getting. But this was the second book on a two-book deal. And so I was delivering it to them for the first time. It was the first time they'd read a first draft from me. And that can also be that can be terrifying, really. It's always terrifying. And so I think more than, I mean, authors that I would love to emulate, you know, Barbara Kingsolver, obviously, she's just amazing. Unsheltered was just such a fantastic book. And actually has similar themes of what a building means and how important a building is to a family and to life in general. But I think really, as a writer, you just have to let go of any, you know, you can't say, oh, I want to write like so-and-so, because you just never will. You can only write as yourself. So I think I just wanted people to enjoy the story, really. I just wanted to write something good. I wanted to write something that people liked reading. And if I've done that, then that's all I can ask for, really, as an author.
Yeah, no, that was probably a really hugely unfair question, really, because it comes back to that genre thing, really, when you're crossing between genres and you're thinking, you know, what is the expectation of the narrative? And I think the thing I will be, and I have been, and I shall continue to in the bookshop be telling people, is this is a great story. You know, the one thing I feel about this is which is why we're trying, you know, not to spoil it for people by saying too much about that, but that you've got this mystery around a bookshop, you've got these compelling characters, and actually what adds to it for me is the fact that it's about intergenerational relationships too. You've got a broad range of characters who the bookshop actually brings together across those usually kind of parallel worlds, that Jilly is meeting Rachel, but then you've also got Edie and Ezra coming there, and you know, the fact that Cullen has been known alongside the bookshop for so many years, it gives you a whole kind of panorama of village life. And the fact that Dora, the local landowner, is probably not going to darken the door of the bookshop, I don't know whether that condemns her to start with. She's not using the shop.
Yeah, absolutely. If you don't go into a bookshop, then it's not a good person.
And then I should say also, if people do have questions at this point, I've got some more to ask, but if anyone has them, do pop them in the chat and we'll come to them. So if there are questions you'd like to ask Sharon, please do. The other element of that family around the shop is, of course, the animal life too, that we have Eustace in the reading you gave us, and we have, is it Bukowski the dog?
Yeah, as in Charles Bukowski, the author. It was so, nearly Fante, but I went for Bukowski. I thought Bukowski was better.
I love the point. I think in the book, do you not, there's a moment when he's introduced and I don't think you point out he's a dog. You're like, Bukowski's in front of the fire. And you're thinking... And there's some lovely bits like that. The fact that I was having to read this again earlier, the fact that we have a runaway goat at one point, and the opening of chapter two begins with Edie seeing a goat knee deep in her perennials is just fantastic. Again, it's like this lovely little glimpse of something which you wouldn't expect, but it adds so much to these being kind of living, breathing lives, how they navigate them with pets and bookshop pets at that.
On there, all life is here. This is a little editorial note. So when she looks at this, when she sees this goat knee deep in her perennials and she's chewing, the goat ignored her chewing happily on the orange princess. It was originally chewing happily on the Bishop of Oxford, which I thought was really funny. But I just couldn't, I changed it the last minute. I couldn't make it work with the months. Like, dahlias are not out in spring. Has to be a tulip, has to be the orange princess. I was really gutted that I changed that at the last minute. I was like, no, I have to accept that it's just not right. But that, and also I don't know, no one's mentioned. I don't know if you got the reference to the name of the goat.
The name of the goat
is Georgette, and her owner Ezra constantly reads historical romances. It's Georgette Heyer. No one's mentioned that.
That's wonderful. That is wonderful. Oh, great! It's such a bookish book in that way, that there are loads of nice kind of references. But I love that you were conscious of the factuality of the plants and when they'd be out in the book to make the integrity of the line stand up. That is something. There's no.
I don't know if anyone would have noticed, but there you go. I knew.
Did you find with The House Beneath the Cliffs, did you get kind of a lot of public feedback? Did people write to you and ask you about, you know, their experiences of it?
I did. I had this absolutely fantastic letter from the fantastically named Mrs. Deverell Morley. I've still got the letter upstairs. She'd handwritten this beautiful letter on gorgeous notepaper. And she and her husband are in sheltered accommodation now. But when she was younger, she's in her 80s, but when she was younger, the family used to go on holiday to Crivet. And she just told me, and she said, I saw your book in Sainsbury's or Morrison's, wherever it was, and I had to buy it. And then she was telling me all of these fantastic stories about this hilarious story about walking into someone's house because she thought it was a cafe in Privy, which is fantastic. Wonderful. And then quite a few people who live in Privy actually have contacted me and said, we really loved it, which is a relief, to be honest. I haven't had anyone that hasn't liked it so far. slightly nerve-wracking. That's the good thing about the Lighthouse Bookshop is it's not a real place, so I can't have someone telling me that I'm doing it wrong. Crivy's just such an extraordinary place. You know, you don't need to exaggerate it at all. It's just a fantastic place.
That's the benefits of a fictional setting. I love that. That's great. So we've got some questions. I will turn to some of these. So we've got one from Adam who says, are you a fan of Stephen King by any chance?
I think he might be referring to our complete Stephen King. Which actually, Adam's, not mine.
You can disown them. Excellent.
I am, definitely. Absolutely. Fantastic.
We'll return to that. That's a good thought. So another question here. Which character would you like to meet in real life?
I really like, other than Dora, I really like all of them. I think probably Edie. Because it just makes me laugh because she's just such a bitch in a really good way. I think I probably want to grow up to be Edie, to be honest.
Did you have fun like writing Edie? Because it feels like there's an abrasiveness there that I kept thinking, oh, it's going to soften. It doesn't soften as easily as maybe narratives like this would usually have. It's like, oh no, she's still going in for all guns every conversation.
Yeah, no, she's spiky, and I like that. I like, you know, she's a woman approaching 70, and she's not giving any quarter at all. She's not slowing down.
Yes,
still got plenty to do. yeah, she makes me laugh.
Well, that almost contemplating setting the goat free early on is something where you know, you set her stall out there, I think.
Of her. I did get an editorial comment about, because at one point she says she's considered bashing both Ezra and the goat over the head with a baseball bat, and the editor said it's a bit harsh. It's like, no, that's staying in there. That's easy.
And another question here: are there novels or topics you'd like to write on, but you kind of hold back because publishers might not want to publish? And how much are you driven by, you know, what publishers are suggesting or dictating in that sense?
Yeah, it's really hard. I don't think there's anything that I wouldn't try and write. Obviously, if you're under contract, then you have to be, you know, you have to think about what the publisher wants. But I think if you're an author who's trying to be published, if you're not at that stage yet, I think you can't think about that. I think you have to write what's in your head. And to be honest, it's the only time when you're doing that first draft, when you're getting a book ready to go to an agent or to a publisher out on submission, it's the only time that you really can write exactly what you want to write, because sooner or later there's going to be edits, and, you know, unless you're self-publishing, in which case, you know, you can absolutely please yourself. I think that the first time you write, you just have to do what you want to do, because otherwise you're just second guessing yourself and you'll go around in circles, and you have to be writing from the heart. You can't second guess yourself. For me, I'm because I have this scattergun approach of just wanting to write everything, trying to decide what I write next can be quite difficult. Like, do I want to write really full on horror? Do I actually want, because I haven't written a full length horror novel yet, but I've got several that are there. And then the decision there is, do I spend 6 months doing that and it not sell? Or do I try and publish something that in the genre that I've published before? So I try not to think about that too much, I think, because there are so many things that will stop you writing, and you adding an extra one is not helpful. So I think you just have to write whatever stories in your head, and then you see what comes later, really. It's the only way to be.
That's lovely. That's lovely to hear too, that it is, you know, it is the point where you can, yeah, construct the thing that you want to make happen before you have to kind of delve for that. Oh, and another great question. Out of everything you've written, which published book is your favorite so far?
Lighthouse Bookshop, actually.
Good.
I don't often say that I'm proud of everything I've written, but I'm not a terribly confident person. But this one I really like. Please read it.
it's nice anyway, because it's on topic, but obviously it's lovely to hear that sense, because there's so much within it. It's such a rich book. And maybe it has to do with that cast again, that you've got so many stories within a story. And I don't know whether even that is in your thinking as you think about genre, that, you know, are you still thinking a lot about the kind of power of community or village life, or, you know, small places in terms of an imaginative prompt for writing?
I think probably, yeah. I think a lot, I don't know why that is, why it's particular. I suppose, the obvious thing is that I live in that is my life. I live in a small community. And so that's what I know to that extent, although that's quite a fairly new thing, last 10 years or so. I think it's just character is what drives me, really. Character is what interests me. The stories, how you can never know another person fully, really. And I think what's interesting to me is how seeing a character and seeing an interaction with one character with another character, and then seeing another character in a different situation, pieces together a whole that you wouldn't otherwise know. And I think possibly that's what I was trying to do with the Lighthouse Bookshop. You know, Edie, as an example, if you just saw her on one bad day, you would just think she was a terrible person. But her interactions with other, or her interactions with Ezra, you would think she was an awful person. But her interactions with other people, they have a different view of her. And then her interactions with Jilly and how Jilly changes her and she changes Jilly. And I think that's just life, isn't it? That's how we connect with other people. And I think that's probably what I'm always trying to do in my writing is show that. is demonstrate that, because that's what life is. And I think that's what I'm trying to do, not necessarily consciously even, but that's why I like writing different characters and why I really enjoyed writing the different perspectives in this, I think.
And does that kind of impulse play into, say, your kind of desire to write more horror as well? Is that part of that, or do you see those as separate? I suppose
I think, oh, that's a really good question. I don't know, actually. I don't know where the horror thing comes from, because I can't even deal with watching horror films most of the time. And yet I'm so often drawn to writing horror and writing darkness. I think, yeah, that's a really good question. I guess it's part of life though, isn't it? The darkness is always part of life. I think you always, as you were saying with the Lighthouse Bookshop and the characters that have got all of that trauma in their past that you don't know about, if you only see Rachel behind the counter in the bookshop, you're never going to know about her dark past, and yet it's there and it's obviously informed her entire life. And that's, I think that's the most effective kind of horror to me, I think. In fact, that's why I love Stephen King so much, actually. The most effective horror that he writes he writes gore really well, he writes body horror really well, but the stuff that I find really horrifying is the stuff that comes out of nowhere, the stuff that, where it's a normal day and something appalling happens, because that is real horror, isn't it? That's like, that's someone not coming home at the end of the day when you are expecting them for dinner. That's, you know, a child disappearing out of the door, not coming back. That's the real terror. And that's part of life. So I think it's me just trying to understand the world, I guess, by writing about those different things.
That's what I was wondering with the Stephen King thing, because again, it comes down to maybe the drive of things which we in bookshops have to put on genre shelves, but actually they are kind of creeping, they're always at the edge of the genre shelf, and you kind of want to put them in three different places in the shop at once, you know, not to feel like they're bounded by any kind of classification really, although publishers and readers like an element of that too. Adam has asked here pertinently too, where can we read your horror writing?
There's a couple of anthologies. There's an anthology coming out, and I see you put me on the spot now because I can't remember the title. I've got the next short story is in an anthology that's out in October from Flame Tree Press. But there's a couple of anthologies, but they're not very easy to find. They're not widely published. But maybe the next thing I write will be a horror. I don't know.
But the next thing that's published, or what you've just finished up now, is the Cumbrian story you were talking about. When can we expect to get a sense of that?
Next year, it's 23, but I'm not quite sure when. Yeah. So that's the next Simon & Schuster book. So the next one in kind of this sits alongside How to Meet the Cliffs and Lighthouse Bookshop. And I can't talk much about that yet, not least because it hasn't been through editing yet and everything could change. But yeah.
That's good. That's a good hint. And then so and someone has asked here, what's next? So we've got that coming next year. You've got the possibility of something kind of horror tinged. You've also got this contribution to an anthology. Is there anything else on the horizon? I know you've had an incredibly productive year this year, really, in terms of on the shelf, we've got the children's book and we've got this. Are there other things in the pipeline too?
I'm still trying to decide what to write for the second half of the year. So the first time I've only had one book to write, which is quite nice. So I get to choose what I'm writing next, which is lovely. I mean, I always get to choose, but like I haven't decided yet. And it might be a cozy crime type book set very much in my village, but isn't my village because I don't want to offend anyone. I think I'd love to write something set in the Cumbrian Fells. So that might well be that's up, that's post-it noted on my wall in my workroom. So that might be the next thing that I write.
That's great. We won't hold you to it. That's fine. That's okay. It's so nice to hear a sense of that kind of flexibility and actually hearing from you now that you're at a position where you've got these books out and you have a bit more kind of a breather and a control over what you do next, which must be, I mean, having written in so many different ways and areas, there must be multiple kind of doors open to you in that sense too.
Yeah, I'm extremely lucky. I mean, I have a fantastic agent who is kind of happy for me to do whatever I want, which I think is not necessarily the way it always is, and she's incredibly supportive, and it is great, but I also often think if I had more focus it would be easier instead of just going, oh yeah, I've got like five different things I want to write. I'm sure it's a problem that every single author has, but sometimes I feel like if I only had one idea it would be much easier, and I'm sure everyone thinks that, but I'm very lucky that I have an agent who's very happy for me to go, yeah, I'm just going to go write some weird horror thing for the next couple of months. And she'll be like, yeah, right then. That's fine.
That's great. And to have that kind of support. I mean, do you find actually, you know, kind of working in Cumbria that has affected your kind of writing support to an extent? Have you, you know, been a part of anything or kind of are your writing connections sort of mainly about yourself and your writing process, or are you connected to other writers in any way?
I mean, I'm quite a loner anyway, so I'm very happy sitting in a room staring at the wall and my screen for most of the time. I think I started writing full-time after I'd moved up here, and I sometimes miss going to book launches and things like that. I think that would, networking wise, I think that's probably quite an important thing to do. But in terms of actually just being able to sit and write, I would never be able to do that if I was living anywhere else. So, and I, you know, absolutely love that. So I love the fact that I can do that and I wouldn't change that for anything. And that's also where social media comes in, that, you know, obviously it has good and bad aspects. It can be very distracting, but it's also an amazing network for meeting other authors online and just discovering people who are in the local area that wouldn't otherwise necessarily know were here, or and indeed further afield. So I don't feel isolated in that way. I think I've probably got more of a network of writer friends now, really, than you know, 10 years in the past when Twitter wasn't really a thing and Zoom wasn't a thing. So yeah,
that, I mean, that's really fascinating, because we find the same in the bookshop actually, that the bookshops have probably traditionally been quite isolated spaces and then have actually networked themselves a lot more over the last certainly 2 or 3 years, and have been able to kind of share what's going on and to feel a sense of kind of kinship and community too when it's really been necessary, which I think benefits authors as well, because we're always, you know, talking about books, so we tend to tell
them absolutely, yeah,
what we're loving. But in that sense, you know, are there books that we should be reading? Are there things that you would recommend that we should be reading now, or things that you've loved that you wanted to recommend?
I have a list.
Excellent.
I've just read this. which is Tomorrow and Tomorrow and Tomorrow by Gabriel Zevin, which is just fantastic. And it's about, I've said this on Twitter, but it's about two people build games, except that as with all the best stories, it's about everything else. And it's just fantastic. She wrote, actually, incidentally, her last book was The Storied Life of AJ Fikri, which is another story about a bookshop and a slightly curmudgeonly bookseller, funnily enough, which was fantastic, absolutely wonderful book. So when I saw this coming out, it's like, have to read it. And it's just fantastic. I couldn't put it down. Just wonderful. There's a book coming out. This is actually a proof copy, but this is the final art, I think, for the card Cackle by Rachel Harrison, which is out in September. And I really loved it. It kind of gives off practical magic vibes with kind of frozen undertones, but for adults. It's great. I loved it. That's really worth coming. That's Titan Books, and that's out in September. And then I'm also reading Janina Ramirez's Femina, which is great. Femina being the term for when, during the Middle Ages, when documents were being erased, you know, being wiped out for various reasons, anything written by a woman or involving women were labelled Femina and were got rid of. So this is kind of reconstructing the history of the women that were lost in that period. And it's particularly interesting for me because it kind of touches on themes that I was writing about in Katie Willicott about, and actually to a certain extent in the Lighthouse Bookshop about how easy it is for names to be forgotten and lost when they're not recorded. I'm currently reading this, which is a wonderful present from a wonderful bookseller. Will,
we Polly. Love recommending bookshop books is our thing.
Another bookshop about another novella about a bookshop, a traveling bookshop, Parnassus on Wheels, which is a fantastic novella. And finally, I would recommend, this is quite an old book now, but I would, maybe beginning of last year, George Saunders' A Swim in the Pond in the Rain, which is one of the best books I've read. I love the short story genre anyway. And it's George Saunders, his course that he teaches about Russian short literature. And it's just one of the best books I've read about the art of writing, really. It's just beautiful. It's really beautiful. So I'd recommend, and you don't have to be a writer to be interested in it. I think it's just a really interesting treatise on short fiction and what it gives us, really.
He's so good talking about writing, isn't he?
It's not at all patronizing, and he didn't go over my head. Often I find it difficult to read books about writing because I feel it makes me feel like a failure. Like I didn't know I was supposed to be doing all of this. I don't know what that means. What is that word? I'm gonna have to look it up. And he's not like that at all, and I just feel like he would be exactly the kind of tutor that you want. It's exactly the kind of university lecturer you would want. It's really good.
Well, thank you for all of those recommendations. That's wonderful. And it's always great to get a kind of a writer's take on interesting writing coming out, and yeah, to send us away to more books once we've finished the Lighthouse Bookshop, obviously. there are those other things to divert ourselves with, and also gives a good array of your kind of interests, I think, in that breakdown there, the kind of different sort of history, fantasy, and
books, a brain approach, story. Yeah.
That's and reflects the best bookshops, which are themselves eclectic spaces that yeah. allow you to become yeah. fascinated,
learn about anything you want.
Yeah. Totally. And I'm sure if you visit Withnail Books in Penrith and see Adam, he will send you on those multiple pathways too. So
well, he knows so much about every single book out there. Fantastic. Just said, oh yeah.
There you go. That's kind of what bookshops want to do, isn't it? To put you in a pathway of something curious and different and interesting, as well as being that great community space. Not all of them can be like the bookshop in the Lighthouse Bookshop and provide on-site chess or baking, but obviously those that do are fantastic, and we love reading about them fictionally and visiting them in real life. And I'm so thankful we've got a chance to chat to you this evening, Sharon, and to talk
thank you very much
the Lighthouse Bookshop. And thank you everyone for joining us this evening.
Yeah, thanks everyone, I really appreciate it.
This has been wonderful. So if you do have any other questions, do put them towards us at some point. I'm sure we can always forward anything on that, you know, if you've got particular geographical concerns or about civic planning in the area of historic buildings and how it affects development issues, anything that kind of crops up once you've read the Lighthouse Bookshop, please do send them our way. But thank you once again to everyone for taking part this evening. It's been a joy, and I'm really looking forward to what else comes from Sharon in the future. So yeah, keep your eyes on numerous bookshelves for that.
Thanks a lot, everyone.
Thanks, everyone. And good night. Good night, everyone.
Good night.